the drama about? I'm just a normal guy.
Yeah, you're just a normal guy with almost a 700 million power freaking account. What are you, like 685 now? And your other one's 485?
Look man, listen. It's a unconfirmed rumor. And some may or may not be obsessed with this particular fact. But a lot of people that I fight against think that I actually play a dev account. Which
really?
Is fucking hilarious. Yeah, bro, it's fucking hilarious.
You're upsetting like, you're upsetting a lot of the younger players. They're like, yo, yeah, we're playing against YY, so yeah, our season's pretty much chunked. Apparently, someone's been playing you like playing against you guys like a few seasons in a row.
I know. The thing is, I'm actually, you know, I'll tell you what I did this season, and it's kind of intentional, but not intentional at the same time. Like, you know how, I'm sure you can relate to this somewhat, like, you know how you, if you fight the same people three seasons in a row, it's actually not fun for anyone.
Mm-hmm.
Like, no one's having fun, right? Like, no, you know what to expect, they know what to expect, you know all the people, they're gonna shit talk, it's the same shit, like, what's the point, right? So, I said to ourselves, you know, guys, fuck it, let's just desync ourselves, instead of fighting the same people, which we know guarantee we'll get, we'll just fight somebody else a little different. See how it goes. We're probably going to lose, but see how it goes. So, I don't know. Like, I played this game. I played games like this for a long time, like Call of Dragons, Rise of Kings before this.
Ooh.
I just don't understand the fucking drama, bro. Let's just play the game. Enjoy the game. Who the fuck cares? Play the game.
What was your power? What was your power in Rise of Kingdoms?
I played for the first 2.5 years. I peaked around 450. At that time, Baba was already, I think, 800.
This is fucking insane, dude.
But I was 450, and I had probably close to, like, 30 million dead troops.
Jesus and Christ. Do you still play Rise of Kingdoms?
No, I don't have time. I got, like, those were good. Those were legit good times because the game was less complicated back then. Now I look at Rise of the Kingdoms, it's a different game. It's a different game. Those were the good times back in the day, as with most games. Most games, years 3 and 4 are like the best of times, and it kind of goes downhill from there. And, you know, year 3 was really good for ROK, but, you know, I kind of got sick and tired of, you know, every KVK. And back then, you couldn't skip KVKs. I was just, like, up, like, until fucking 3 a.m., 4 a.m. And then I had a full workday thereafter for like a week.
Damn.
I was like fucking walking my dog, bro. And like some Korean guy was like, you know, rallying my pass that I had to defend. That was not fun.
Rise of Kingdoms, what's up?
I was just going to ask a question from like a person that's not a whale. Cause like when it's a very mean thing to say, like, oh, but like to ask an individual, like, Mr. 700 fucking million, that's insane. Like, so like then how does the game change when you have that much power when you play it? Like, that'd be interesting to think about as you play.
Honestly, the one thing people should appreciate, and is a truth, is there is non-linear scaling, if you think about it, right? So what is non-linear scaling? I'll answer your question directly, but I'll get to the facts, because people are obsessed with power. Power in itself means nothing for one or two reasons. The general principles are, there's people who have power, but there's people who have power but are afraid to lose power. That's a big difference. There's people like Nephisto who doesn't care about losing like 600 million power. That's fucking crazy. Right? In Rise of Kingdoms, there are like a lot of whales who are like 400 million power but were scared to lose troops. So it's the principles behind what you do with that power that matter a lot, that ultimately defines whether someone's actually a whale or like a baby goat, right? Like, that's first and foremost most important. The game experience in and of itself, it's baby goat. Like, it's for real. Like, you know, you see somebody in the field, they fight for an hour, and then they're fucking offline. You know, they're a little bitch, right? We all know who they are. Sure. Like, you know them, I know them, we all know them. We're not going to call names because we're nice people, but that's the truth. That's the truth. We know who they are, right? But in
you guys
game,
have played...
Like,
that's not
in this
though.
Game, you drop like, power. Like, it doesn't matter. But, you know, like, power means something to some people. To the players that really are like hardcore PvPers, like power is just a number. And I personally respect people who just say troops are meant to die, which I agree with. So that's first and foremost. You set the principles behind what power means. Second, there is nonlinear scaling in terms of power. What do I mean by that? So, you know, we all know there's a big experience between, let's just say you're a 20 million power player to a $50 million power player. I almost said $50 million.
Jesus Christ.
$50 million, bro. Like $50 million power player. Big difference between 20 and 50 million. We all know what that is, right? And we all know at 50 million, there's a big difference in quality in terms of commanders and artifacts, right? Big difference between a 50 million power player who just has like entry level shit to a 50 million power player who has all the commanders and all the artifacts. Big difference, right? And then because of how troop scaling works, there's also a big gap between 50 million and 150 million, right? Just because of the sheer number of troops. And because of how much stamina scales in this game at 230, right, in this latest season, 232, with this latest season versus 150 in season 2 and 105 in season 1, there's a different level of scaling at 150 to call it 300 million plus. The reason is it's just sheer number of troops, and ultimately, at the end of the day, the sheer willingness to lose troops. Not because of how the policies work, because you gotta think about it. If you max all your policies in terms of healing, and this game's meta is all about resource healing, you can heal 33 million troops. 33 million troops in one go. Actually, technically, you can do up to 40 million plus or minus, but call it 33 million troops. So that's equivalent to 33 million power. Sorry, 330 million power. You can heal in all go in one go through max daily healing plus 2 days of stockpile. It's 33 million. So you imagine the gap, right? A 150 million power player, you cannot sustain that. To have gotten to 350 million above, you have a fuckload of resources, right? Like, so right now I'm sitting on like mana of 21 billion. I have 21 billion mana right now. I have 21 billion mana. I don't know how much 21 billion mana can heal, but I bet you it's probably close to 100 million troops.
I mean, if you have, if you have like some good villages and diligence and all that stuff on, I think someone sent me like the picture that they're saying for at least for the season that we're in right now, it's 75 million mana per million T5. First season of Strife is about 64-65.
Yeah,
I have a question for you.
Go ahead.
Please. So
legend, tell me. Legend,
one of the main things, anytime your name is brought up, obviously Nephisto gets brought up. If you and Neph were ever in the same Strongest Lord, would you ever try to go toe-to-toe with him?
Win. Come on, get the fuck out of here. Are people on crack?
that's one of the main like, things that people were saying. Who would go crazy?
Listen, man. Here's what's realistic. A Strongest Lord is 200 sculptures, right? To get first space.
Mm-hmm.
A full purchase of Heroes of Temeris bundle is 40. That is $185. So that's 5 days of Heroes of Temeris. You have to be willing to pay close to over $900 worth of resources to get to $900 worth of resources and speed ups to get number one. What is the only reason other than pride, which it goes something for this game?
It's an ego battle.
To get number
bro.
One this game.
It's a now, fucking ego battle.
It's ego battle. And like, is it worth? Like, I bet you if he and I went against each other in Strongest Lord, he'd probably train, like, I don't know, probably close to 40 million power. And I would probably train close to 40 million power. Guess who wins? Neither of us. That's the truth. No one wins. Like, no one's going to win. So what the fuck is the point?
They're going to win because they're going to get your money.
Yeah, exactly. Like, It's the fucking game developers that win. We lose. So actually, in a scenario like that, what I would actually propose to Neff, if we're ever in that situation, which I doubt we will, to be honest, because you guys are in way different league, and you guys are way stronger than we are. We're not even close. That's the truth. We all can admit to that.
What heroes did you guys just get recently?
I'm sorry, say that again?
What heroes are you guys at right now with your with
so we
your
got
group?
Unlocked everything. We got unlocked everything, but as you can imagine, before and the reason why I decided to enter this season was because we could not accumulate G3 sculptures. We cannot. I would have stayed for one more season I would have skipped one more if I knew we could accumulate more G3 sculptures. But the reality is, if the longer that we wait to go into G3, the weaker that we would be relative to everyone else, right? Because all of our, you know, competitors would be accumulating more and more G3 sculptures, and at some point, you actually are just significantly far behind. Because imagine if we were faced with Nuar, you would have 3 seasons to accumulate G3 sculptures, whether free to play or spending, and all your commanders would be maxed, and we'd enter in season G3 with like no sculptures. So we just got released all the commanders, like every single one. But the issue is no matter how much money you spend right now, based on my calculations, we cannot max any commander duo full expertise before gate 3 opens. That's our challenge right now. Like I'm maxing. I'm number one in literally every single event. I'm buying the daily commander bundles and did all the calculations. I can't max commander pair by gate 3. So that's our challenge, and that's why relatively it's a bit more difficult for us. And we've accepted the fact and the reality that the first season in G3, or season 3 rather, will be a very difficult one. And it is what it is. That's just the truth and reality of things.
That's true.
Right? I've seen for those that played Rise of Kingdoms, does anyone remember JWM?
That sounds familiar. I'm sure. Okay, we have some OGs in the chat right now that are also Rise of Kingdoms.
OGs, like a lot of OGs back in the day. If you remember JWM, I think JWM was like Kingdom 95 or something like that, or 94 or something like that. But back in Rise, they had like at the time the top 3 players in Rising Kingdom. It wasn't even close. It was like Baba, another guy that was 600 million, and like a few others. They were the most powerful alliance in Rising. It wasn't even close. But the reality was JWM got to a point, from my understanding, that they were scared to lose KVKs because they were so powerful. And they were just focused on power. And they were afraid to lose.
That's Guardian. Appreciate the fire, bro.
Ultimately, 143 fell apart after seasons because they cut a bunch of bad deals to make sure that they wouldn't lose, and they did everything and everything to make sure that they wouldn't lose, and ended up with a kingdom of like farmers and things like that. My principal philosophy from learning that experience is: one, don't be of that mindset. First of all, losing in this game, honestly, the consequences are more spiritual in the sense, because like who. Like it's about like the morale of defeat rather than the reward or the tangible aspects of it, right? Because like you lose the dragon, like it's like one sculpture or one of the tokens, or you know what I mean. It's like, do you care? Like some people care. Like I don't really give a shit. I just want to make sure we have a good team. And the way that you figure out who is good on your team or not, who stays, who is a farmer, or who's not, is those who stay through all of that. So you almost, in some instances, want to lose. Not ideal, obviously. I'm not saying that's like the base case. No one wants to lose in the base case. We spend money to fucking win, not to lose. Let's be real. Okay, that's why it's called pay to win, not pay to lose.
Some people, you know, may say pay to like lose.
Real talk. You know, like real talk. But, you know, like that's the truth. That's how you figure out the resilience of your kingdom and how good is your team, right? So our general ethos is like, you know, and I try to set expectations on my team that it is what it is. We're in it to have a good time. It's a game. Have a good time. This is not going to be the last game that we play together. This is probably going to be the first game that we play together. And it is what it is, man. Like, you lose. Someone's better than you. Just say you're better than them. Get better. Be more active. Kick people. Burn people if you need to. Like, get them to move out. Who the fuck cares? Just move on. That's my ethos.
You gotta be competitive. How many did other players come with you from Rise of Kingdoms, or did you just come over?
No,
by yourself?
Man, like for real. One day I was like, you know,
I'm curious, bro, because it's like you're just saying you're that in Rise lie. Of Kingdoms, right, you're 450 look, million power, and you're like, bro, fuck it, I'm going to Call of Dragons and double that power.
You know, I actually, when Call of Dragons was just about to come out, I was like, am I going to play this piece of shit, or am I just going to, like, fuck off, right? This was season one. And I said to myself one or two things. I'm telling you, like, you know, this is story time with fucking Grandpa YY, I know, but I'm just giving you context, if you will.
Grandpa, you don't sound like you're old.
But for entertainment's sake, let's call me Grandpa YY. So like, for real, you know, when this game came out, like, I got on, like, the whole beta thing, and I was like, they invited me to play, and I was like, I don't know, man, like... I wasn't sure if it was for me at the time. I just got a significant promotion at work.
Oh, congrats, bro.
I didn't know I could. This was like multiple years ago, so it's like old news. You know, I wasn't sure if I would be like mentally committed to it. And also at the same time, as we all know, like, year one of a game generally kind of sucks. To be honest, like, most games, most MMOs like this, we're not MMO, we're games like this, 6 months to a year, it's kind of like not great, right? It's actually out of the ordinary that games are like fucking perfect right off the bat. And honestly, reviewing old tapes of this game, I think that's the truth. Like, it wasn't clear that this was going to be like an amazing game. It was better than ROK in some aspects. It wasn't clear that it was going to be like an amazing game day one. So I was like, I'm not sure this is going to be amazing. I'll just watch it. And God honest, one day I was just like exhausted from work, just from like working really long hours. And I was like, you know what? Fuck it. I'll just try it. You know what I mean? Like,
What is your definition of just trying it out? Just getting like T5 by the first gate?
If you play like those games...
My guild members make fun of me all the time. Because you know what they say to me?
RuneScape. You guys ever play RuneScape?
You know, my people on my team, they always make fun of me. They're like, bro, fuck off. They're like, dude, fuck off. I'm like, what do you mean? They're like, you know your attention span with any video game is you spend like thousands of dollars and you quit after a game. So like, fuck off. You quit after a week. So fuck off. Don't bother me. No one wants to play any games with me because I quit after like a week.
So you have Rise of Kingdoms, and what other games have you whaled out on?
I spent a lot on Genshin, but I was like I didn't really get that interested in it. To be honest, it was fun for like a week, and then I had someone pilot my account for a year. Like, and then I logged in, I'm like, oh, it's a nice account. I'm not gonna play it.
Tran in the chat said, can you ask YY please to not burn my city this KVK, please? Thank you.
No, but I played hardcore on Lost Ark.
I never got into Lost Ark. I never even gave it a try. Yeah, that's what I hear.
Lost Ark. Well, now it's a little bit of a dead game. I played Lost Ark when it was on a Russian server. I probably have my ID and shit stolen now by this point. But you know, like, I played Lost Ark on a Russian server. It's probably one of the most fun I've had in a video game competitively, without the drama. But it's a very, very, it's a zoomer game. There's no, like, you can't be shit. There's no casual. You have to, it's like either you're hardcore or you're a pleb. It's binary. It's the truth. Like, I don't know anyone who's like played Lost Ark for like 3 years who's like a pleb. They don't exist. So, you know, it comes with, I mean, it's I'm pretty try hard game. I play. Yeah, it's like, you gotta try hard. Like, if you don't want to try hard, then don't play the game. So there's no point. I used to play a lot of Dota. It's not pay to win. I used to play a lot of Dota. Like, I don't know how much my skins are worth right now, but they're worth a lot because I've been playing for like 10 years. And that's really much it. Like, oh, and then just like, there's a lot of games I spend like probably a few grand on that I just lose track of. And my buddies are like,
insane.
You know, the buddies in
sounds like
in
a good problem to have.
Yeah, all my buddies in Alliance joke with me because they're like, if he can't spend money in this game, he doesn't want to play. And that's the truth. Like, you know, throwing Liberty, like, seems okay. Like, but
I'm so behind. Like, I've been wanting to give a game like that a try. And that game is, I guess, kind of like an opportunity for me to get on it early. Like, I tried New World and I couldn't really get into it, but...
Yeah, you can get into it. It's not the vibe. It's not the right vibe. TL is actually a reasonable vibe. Lost Ark was a really great vibe, but... You know, the game's going a bit downhill. Has gone a bit downhill. You know, I don't know. I think we're all honestly, as gamers, and I'm sure your chat is full of gamers or gamers. You know, everyone's looking for the next thing to play, right? Like, we all want, I think most people are desperate for like a good MMO to play, right? Like, that's the truth. Most people want a good MMO to play or something that's like, you know, you can build something that's creative, something that you can play for a while and just grind the fuck out of, right? Without being monetized like a little bitch. But that's the truth, right? Like,
yeah.
That's the truth. But, you know, like, games like that these days don't really exist. And those that do come out in that way end up being bad. Or turn out to be for the worse after you've invested, like, 6 or 9 months into it. Which is why, sadly, the gaming industry, wherever you see something that's released, it's like... usually shit reviews day one. So I'm not sure. Personally, I'm waiting for the next thing to play. The classics to me don't do much anymore. Like, I used to play pretty hardcore WoW back in the day. Not anymore. Like, I just don't see any appeal to it. So, you know, like, I log on.
Probably just got burnt out from it.
Yeah, like, you know what I mean? Like, it's just like, why am I doing this? You know what I mean? Like, what's the point? And honestly, for me, it got to a point where in hyper-competitive MMOs like that, I ended up just, like, paying people to pilot my account, like, in WoW. Mm-hmm. And I was just, like... And then you log on, you lose the feel, right? Which is why for this account, like, in Call of Dragons, I don't let people pilot my account. I force myself to play. So, because, you know, other people, obviously, other top players, I mean, obviously, this is a sensitive topic. But the truth is, bored. Many top players...
You get bored easily, though.
Is your username YY? I'm trying to search your account.
I'm on server 314, so you can look for it. I'm in KBK 4007, season 3. Like, the thing is, when the moment that you let people pilot your account is the beginning of the end.
Because you don't care enough to a point where you want enough to do it. You want someone else to do it. And you're like, but I've already invested so much money, so why would I give this up? But I still want to keep this active because I've invested so much, and I understand. Exactly. I understand.
Exactly. Like, that is the downfall of people who let other people pilot their account for a significant amount. And I know people do. I'm sure you all know, and I don't think this is speculation at this point. And, you know, all due respect to the LOP guys, I don't know them well, but I know of them and I know the politicking behind the scenes and all the drama and all the bullshit. And, like, you know, like, when Villa let other people pilot his account, that was the beginning of the end. And, you know, he hasn't been active for a few seasons from what I've heard. And it's not a shocker that, like, they're migrating somewhere else and the kingdom is done. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think that's breaking news. I think that's widely known at this point. Mm-hmm. And again, as I say, like, much respect, you know, because they were very, very strong. Like, to build a kingdom like that, you got to do a lot of persuasion. And we're not that kingdom, obviously, and we aspire to be like that one day. But, you know, like, the moment that your leader lets someone pilot your account and make all the decisions, your kingdom is no more. And you're no longer the same player.
You're not wrong there.
Yeah, like,
because, like, you feel like you have this connection. You're like, oh shit, buddy's like 250, and all of a sudden it's like, oh, he sold his account, and like, it's not the same guy anymore.
It's not the same. And so,
Chad said, "What's piloting?" Question mark.
No, like,
you got to get your license there, broski.
I mean, in some country, like, you know, I mean, I'm not going to throw shade, and I'm beyond the point, because I accept the fact that no matter what game you play, okay, let's be for real. No matter what game you play, Call of Dragons, Rise of Kingdoms, whatever fucking PvP game like this.
How you doing, my bro?
You will always, always.
We don't discuss things against you.
You always have pilots. You always have resource bots. You always have people who bot. Guaranteed. You will try your best to not have that in your kingdom, but you'll watch other people, and I'm not going to name names. I know there's a lot that are out there. I'm not naming anyone who's on this stream for sure. Like, I sure as hell don't know anything, because I don't give a fuck about what their other games do. But sometimes I just watch them like, oh, that's interesting.
That looks weird.
That looks a little weird.
But nah, you know, bro, listen. They're just very coordinated, bro, all right?
They're hyper-coordinated to the millisecond. Dude, they're so fucking good at the game that one person plays with 30 mice at the same time. And 30
NTS,
keyboards.
Bro. NTS, bro, I played against them last season. I'm like, what is going on? I'm so happy not to play against them this season.
You know, it is what it is, and it is what it is, right? Like, games like this, you're always going to have it. And the truth is, the developer, I'm not throwing shade, because I actually think the developers of this game, all else equal, are better than the intent behind Rise of Kingdoms. And I've seen all the good and all the bad in Rise of Kingdoms. I'm saying these guys are good developers. I'm not a paid agent. I'm not a fucking Chinese spy. I'm
just telling you. He's a dev confirmed.
Fuck you guys.
Why? The rumors are true.
I didn't want to say that you sounded
the
Asian.
The rumors are
true.
Let me tell you something, though. Rise of Kingdoms was a ploy to get you to spend more and more money. And you had spend more and more money to be competitive, because that game was about rallying and garrisons. If you didn't have the latest rally, if you didn't have the latest garrison, you were fucked. You were going to lose. Basically it. And by the way, the value for those who are whales and don't remember Rise of Kingdoms, and I'll remind you how expensive shit was in Rise of Kingdoms. A $185 bundle in Rise of Kingdoms. Guess how many commander sculptures it got you? Take a wild fucking guess.
I'm trying to remember. I don't think I ever maxed that one. I just did wheels, but...
anyone 15? I'm not looking at your chat right now, but can anyone in chat guess a max purchase of Commander Bundle?
I know Strange knows. I know Strange.
How many sculptures was that?
Probably like 100 American or something minimum.
No, it was $185, but how many sculptures? How many legendary Commander sculptures did that yield you in a $185 package?
If I was so frustrated about how much something cost, I would definitely work for that person that made me pay for something, so I didn't have to pay for it.
Face of Blade said 12. Solo said 6.
Six.
Homelander's trolling and said 69. Of course, there's always has to be that guess.
I love you. I love you guys, but fuck you.
Amia said 20. Strange said 30.
Guys,
you want your money, man.
The answer was 7.
What?
Now, to be fair, the daily commander things that you got from VIP, instead of getting 2 per day, you got a whopping 3 per day in Rise of the Kingdoms. Okay, guys? So every single day, if you max purchase commander bundles, you got the daily, it's 10 sculptures a day. It's still 690 to max one commander. But imagine the cost where you had a new commander meta released, okay, and you only got 10 for $185 a day. Think about that. In Call of Dragons, we get 45 effectively if you buy the 20 bundle by the end of the week. So it's 45 effective per week versus 10. Think about that. I mean,
besides bundles, like Rise of Kingdoms, as you know, has like all kinds of crazy shit, like with the equipment, what was it, the crystal tech, like, bro, they go crazy. But I mean, I Call of Dragons, you know, as much as people don't want like a lot of like new pay to win stuff getting introduced, like it's bound to continue happening. Like, they're going to try to make some money some form, but hopefully they work on the balance of it, you know? We've suggested, cosmetics. I think people will spend hella money on cosmetics.
Oh, fuck yeah, man. I want to look at it like a little pink fairy. Like my boy Guns. Like Guns, if there's a little Pink Fairy City theme, I better see you on stream fucking wearing like a
dude, listen, tutu, I already got trolled with the tank one because I was thinking about pushing during that time, which I should have, fucking hell. But anyways, people were fucking making little memes and shit with me having the little fairy wings. They're like, yeah, that's very manly coming into the front line with some fairy wings.
Bro, if you wore a tank top with fairy wings, I don't owe you a grand, okay?
A tank top with fairy wings?
No. Guns, get some fucking fairy wings, bro.
Chad, do I lose my dignity for $1,000?
Listen, homie.
It's like Marlon Wayne wearing a dress.
Listen, homie, here are the following conditions. You gotta wear a pink tank top, a tutu, fairy rings, and a hair clip.
No, hell no.
I think he's part of the Illuminati, yo. I think he's part of the Illuminati, yo. It's getting kind of dark.
Challenge accepted, said Strange. I mean, Strange, that'd be easy for you, right? There's cheating in almost every K. Can lose it. Guys, if you guys have any questions for YY, right now is your guys' chance. I just realized 105 of you guys in here right now. So if any of you guys have any questions for YY, put them in the chat and we'll ask them. I'm recording this for sure. Going to go for YouTube. A lot of people are interested in your name always gets brought up. That's why when you were saying, is this the Guns? I'm like, is this the YY? No. Like,
I mean, it's crazy. I know, honestly, look.
I know Guns. I don't know YY, but I'd say YY. Where'd the money come from?
That's a personal question.
Before I answer that question, I'll
if
just
you're,
say.
If you're willing to answer that, there is a
few. No,
there.
It's, no, I think I don't. I'll put it this way. I don't do anything that's that different from Neff. You have to know the answer to that question first. But Neff, because I was personally, because when I came back, I'll tell you a story. When I was thinking about coming back to a game like this, I was just like, I'm curious who the big players are right now. And, you know, like fucking YouTube and the algorithms kept on showing me Neff. I'm like, what the fuck? Get the fuck out
Bro,
of my YouTube feed.
That is freaking premium marketing right there, dude. They're targeting whales.
I'm like, you know, all I had in my fucking YouTube feed before was like K-pop videos, like stupid dog memes, and then like Neff. I'm like, what the fuck? Get the fuck out of my, you know, like my live feed or my feed. And so I would just say what I do is not too different from what Neff does for a living. And if you go back and try to understand who Neff is as a person, Neff actually gave an interview to somebody a while back. I don't know if it's the same Neff that plays the game, but when I heard Neff and heard how he described his career and what he does, and if you know what that is, I'm not that different from what he does. So you guys have to do a little bit of research. I'm not just going to fucking tee it up.
Respect.
On a,
Oh, yeah. No,
when you put what I mean? In like, words. Yeah. Yeah, like, it's not, look, man, there's only so many ways you can make money in life. You can start a business. You can work for someone, be supremely successful. You can do something illegal, which I don't do. Yes. I'm not of that ilk. But yeah, you can go back. You know, there's plenty of videos about Neff. Much respect to Neff. For sure, you can go back and he's to be honest, he's like orders of magnitudes more of a whale than I ever desired to be. But you know, he puts in a lot of you can go back and listen to his old videos. You know, he's done stuff like this before. He's pretty chill.
I've seen a few of his interviews, yeah.
Yeah, like it's out there, and I'm not that different from him. So, and it probably shouldn't be surprising, to be honest.
All right, Trent asks, is YY asks, are you Chinese?
I am Chinese American, and yeah, I'm Chinese American. I don't know how much more to say about that.
Neff, 1 billion in Rock and 1.2 billion in COD and 10 billion in real life, said Dragon.
Yeah, I mean, you can't deny that. I mean, the man fucking created a billion power in season 1 of Call of Dragons. How is that competitive? Like, I will never do that and never be willing to do that. Like, that's a different game, man. Neff said in one of his interviews, and I don't mean to misquote him. If I misquote him, apologies. But what I remember from one of his interviews was he said the developers in another game that he wanted to play, not Call of Dragons and not Rising Kingdoms. I'm not stirring up any fucking drama. It's literally what he said. The developers in one of the other games that he wanted to play literally created a server for him so he can spend and catch up with unlimited bundles. That's respect. Like, I don't think I ever got to a stage where a developer was willing to create a fucking server for me. But he did say that in an interview. If you go back, I think it was like a Chisco interview, like way back, way, way back. You know, like, that's not me, but it is what it is. And that's why I say it's not like, you know, people are like, oh, like this. No, like, we're not even. The guy is like spending multiples than I ever would. Let's be real. Like, it's not the same. It's not the same.
So we also have the fifth person saying, why join Noir?
I'm not a big fan of big alliances. I mean, I respect people that run big alliances. But for me personally, I know if I join a big alliance, I would actually play less, not more. Mm-hmm. So, you know what I mean? Because, like, I'm in it because I like my team. I like my people. We have a pretty good ethos. And everyone, like, we don't just play this one game together. We play other games together. We're fucking around. We're dicking around. We're memeing. We're like, ah, fuck this guy. Fuck that guy. Fuck this guy. You know, like, who the fuck cares? So, and in a big alliance, it's just not the same. Like, there's different expectations. People are in it for different reasons, as you know, right?
Oh, yeah.
And I just want, like, you know, when we take migrations, I'm not going to take in 100 people, bro. I might take in 20 max. Because, you know, I want people to like each other and slowly build it over time. Because I've seen it both ways. In Rising Kingdoms, I saw people take in, like, fucking 200, 300 people at the same time. They lose a season, and then they lose 200, 300 people at the same time. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that's not for me.
That's Have you guys ever played the game where you got, like, what you call your merry men, like, your, like, good group of people, and, like, maybe you all hop in and, like, you all do something coordinated together? And then you're like, oh, I'm in a big alliance, and, like, that aspect in which you're talking about kind of taken away from it?
I think there's a little bit of that. I think it's all a question of what do you personally want and what are the expectations of your team? Like, if my team said to me, guys, we want to be the number one alliance as defined by what in this game? We want to be number one in that. Then I would say, well, let's go for it. But to me, I'm not throwing shade. I'm just telling you, for me personally, being number one is like winning, but having fun. That's why our model is like work together and have fun. Because I don't see the point of like playing like super hardcore and it's not fun. It's a game. You know what I mean? Like, we want to be the strongest alliance that's active, that works with each other and have fun. And that could be our alliance is 11 billion. That could be our alliance is 18 billion. That could be our alliance at 8 billion. Like, I don't fucking care, to be honest. Like, it's just a number. So if people are having fun and we got good ethos and people like each other, you know, I don't really see like the pride behind being like a top 10 alliance. I mean, kudos to those that can successfully run it because like, God knows how fucking hard that is. So, like, full respect. I know it's hard. Being R4, R5 with Big Kingdom, man, that's like, I already make too much money, and I don't want to do something that pays no money and has all the downside. Like, fuck that, bro. Like, for real. Like, fuck that. Like, I'm not signing up for that shit. Fuck that.
For your alliance, like, what kind of structure do you guys got set up for your leadership?
What do you mean for that? Like, what?
Like,
I can answer the question, but I want to answer your question.
Yeah. So, for example, there's some people that have like a kind of like a council Like, they'll have, like, their 10 R4s or whatever, but they'll have, like, a set group of, like, four or five people that ultimately end up making all the decisions. Or,
oh, yeah.
Or, do, I mean, you, or do you, or do you run a dictatorship? Because some people are like, nah, why would I run?
He's gonna run. I'm fucking Putin, bro. I am actually Putin IRL.
Oh, shit.
Fucking Neff is Kim Jong-un. That's why I said we're not that different from each other.
Head of departments.
Bro, fucking Neff is gonna sue me now. Holy shit. No, for real. I'll operate with you. I'll say a few things. And they're not perfect. Right? And I come with the perspective that because I have played Rise of the Kingdoms, I generally know what works, what doesn't work. And what risks to take and what risks not to take. And just general principles around games like this. So that's the perspective, if you will. And of course, I will plan out the details with everything. Like building, diplomacy, I'll make a bunch of recommendations. And then what I'll say to others is, what do you guys think? How can we be better? Not only will I communicate R4s, there's basically four tiers to our lines. R4s obviously are privy to the immediate set of information. I actually don't tell our broad alliance much of anything. Because, you know, in games like this, like, people... What's the point of spying? But people, they're spies. People spy and they leak shit. And I'm not all about that. So I tell my immediate R4s. And then I test people. I test with information sharing with a certain set of people. And I see what information gets out. Mm. And the more that I notice things that get out, the smaller that group becomes. So I initially narrow cast very, very, very little information to a certain set of R4s and me, obviously. I'll include a lot of our, shall I say, invested players in the kingdom. That could be widely defined, right? That could be certainly power. But power isn't, you know, be all end all. It's really power, trust, and activity. Players that have power, trust, and activity, I care about their opinion. Because whatever I decide, if you're active and you have power, and, you know, like, I want your opinion. Because ultimately, like, we're going to be dealing with the same shit, right? Like, you're going to play, like, 12 hours with me. I'm not in it to make your life miserable. And so we're going to have fun together, right? So I test a group of people who potentially could be in a decision-making spot or be in a position of influence in the sense that they are in a position to be privy to what is essentially confidential information, but one that could potentially influence the execution thereof. And so I basically take in a lot of input. And what I do is one of two things. One, I define what I try to do. And then two, I take in what other people's recommendations are. And I'll give feedback. Some of it is intentionally meant to teach others so that they know, right? Like, for future decisions, we should consider these parameters, right? And so when other players, they think about the next steps to take, they understand, well, shit, I recommended this last time, but why other people thought this way, then the reason was this, so therefore I'll change and alter my behavior in the future, you know, in future states, right? And so that process is clearly iterative. And there's some people that obviously like that, some people don't like it, and we constantly work people in and out. So to answer a question directly, it's a bit amorphous, but it's a, you know, I set the agenda. I set the general direction of roughly where we're going to go. I let other people debate it, and I communicate the decision to a very small set of group of people. If someone tells me something is a really god-awful fucking idea, which hasn't happened yet, but let's presume that happens.
Yeah.
I'll go with them. Like, I agree with you. We'll try it. It's okay. But, you know, we'll go for it. But so that's on tactics. I'll just say one final thing. Rewards, okay? Like rewards, strongest lords, things like that. It's non-negotiable. It will be proportional to contribution. I am not about giving rewards to people who don't do jack shit. I'm not about favoritism. I'm all about activity. I will supply and buy bundles for people who fight for me in war. I will supply anything, everything for people who are helpful for the greater good, not for themselves. That's one important ethos of the team. Sorry, that was a little bit of a rant, but it is what it is. It's a complicated project. It's a complicated question, and you asked a good question.
No, no, for sure. I mean, and it, based off your answer, it definitely sounds like you have some IRL experience with how to manage people. That's not something like just like your average person with no leadership skills of managing people have. But yeah, you answered the question too. Someone was asking if you help T4 players to get T5. So he answered that, guys. So, I mean, do you want to elaborate on that more? What'd you say?
Look, I mean, like, I'm not, again, I sort of set the principles, right? The principles of this alliance, which is why we codify exactly what we put in our alliance description. We want to play together and have fun. Like, play together and have fun, regardless. And I don't want money to be a gating factor for fun. Imagine if you're at a bar and all your friends were getting piss-ass drunk, and you're the guy in the corner drinking water. Like, how fun is that? Like, if you're the guy that's drinking water, you ain't having fun, right?
That's the DD right there.
Real talk. That's the truth. Like, I haven't met any, unless you're a designated driver, in which case you're fucked. But that's, you know, real talk. That's the truth, right? Like, and you know, to be honest, we all come from different economic paths in life, and you know, I'm of a believer that goodwill in one life or in a moment period of time will be paid forward in a future period of time. And if someone tells me that they love the game and I can see it clearly in their activity, and by this point, to be honest, if you've been playing this game for 3-4 seasons, and if you're a T4 player and free to play, there's a lot of shit that could have fucking gone wrong, and you could have quit the game. Because you know what I mean? Like, how many times do you see like T4 players? You know what I mean? They just quit because they're like, they're stuck at a point, right? And then like, it's game over for them. They can quit easily because they got nothing invested, right?
Yeah.
Now, as a matter of principle, I don't want, as with most things that I deal with in life, I don't want money to be an obstacle to someone's personal enjoyment, especially if I believe the said individual is someone that I value. And by value, I mean someone who is who contributes to what we're aiming to accomplish, who's a good person, right? Because there's a lot of fuckheads who are like in it for the wrong reasons, right? Let's be real about that, right?
That's true.
Who are in it for the right reasons, who are like good for a community. And you know what? Like, you know, I love you. I like you. You know, I want you to have fun, and you know, just put in the time and, you know, help. And, you know, money for me, all else equal, is probably worth less to me than it is to you. Not you as in guns, but I'm just saying broadly speaking. And, you know, it is what it is. And I want you to have fun. I want us all to have fun as a team. I don't want this to be like, oh, you know, fuck, I can't get that artifact and I can't do this. No, I'll take care of it. Don't worry about it. Sheesh. But I'm not going to, you know what I mean? I'm not going to make it.
A few people in chat are like, yep, I'm applying.
You know what? That's the reason why I don't like. This is the reason why I only let 15, 20 people in, and it's only through word of mouth. If I know you through somebody, you're more likely to get in, and I'm more willing to take in like a 45 million power player who is active, who is a good member of the community, who is in it for the right reasons. Or if you're like a 200 million power player who I know you're going to spend, and I'm not going to have to like fucking babysit you, right? You know what I mean?
Like, Cookie Monster is here for the right reason, just so you're aware.
You know what I mean? Like, if you're in it for the right reasons, and we're chilling, we're all having fun, and I'll be honest, just so you guys know, I interview a lot of people through my line of work. I don't interview people, but it just happens to be a byproduct of what I do. I can really quickly tell if you're lying, you're a faker, or just doing something to curry favor. Like, I see that shit through, like, really quickly. So, there's no pretending. That's the worst. If you pretend, that's the worst. You're fucked if you pretend, and I catch you pretending.
What if you just want to have fun?
Go wild, my dude. But anyway, that's my general ethos. And we'll see. I mean, you know, there are other people, like, there's some crazy shit I've heard in this game, man. Like, I'm not this crazy. I heard, I'm not, and again, I don't think this is Noir, And so I don't, and I also don't know anything about Noir, and like, sure as hell, I'm not throwing shade. Mm. I'm just saying what I know about other alliances. There's like other alliances that fucking pay people to show up for war. Like, there's literally people who
are, I have heard that.
There's literally people who are like, you're the
no one even no one even asked me what alliance I was in. I feel so hurt.
I don't think so. I don't know anyone in this game, so I'm not intentionally hurting anybody. I'm just telling you what I know from shall I say sources who are close to the situation, right? And personally, I can see the intent, but I don't see the point. You know what I mean? But that's what happens in this game. Like, this shit happens. And so it is what it is. People choose different method, and I don't know. It's just the game.
All right, so what? I'm curious, right? I know you have everything fucking maxed. But what?
I don't. I'm a plug, please. Come on. Be nice.
Yeah, okay.
Stop fucking teasing me, dude.
Yeah, okay. So, all right. Okay, guys, if you guys didn't know, he's 680 million power. He's free to play. He's just really good at min-maxing, right? As you guys can tell by his answers, very detailed, right? I'm so that's how he plays Call of Dragons, you know, min-maxes. He does his forts.
There it is.
Very articulated.
There it is. Every day. Thank you for the shout out, bro. I was looking for it.
All right.
That made my day. Like, I think I'm just good. I can call tomorrow off. I'm not going to work anymore tomorrow.
There you go.
Take the day off. 700 million.
Easy. What were you gonna ask?
I was gonna tell you. So like, I'm sure some devs are probably gonna watch this. Like, if you had one, maybe two things that you would like to see changed in the game, like what are some things that you would suggest? Because I mean, you have experienced Rise of Kingdoms and other games. So it's like, what are your thoughts on that?
Look, whatever I'm going to say is bound to be unfair for someone, right? Because what I would want to see change may not be necessarily what is the best for the game or for the broad population or period. That's the truth, right? Because like, we have different agendas. I'm not saying we're playing two different games. We are kind of playing a little bit two different games, right? As I sort of said, there's a little bit of a nonlinear power curve. My only hope in the future is essentially one thing. And I think we can all more or less agree to this. Actually, two things. One, don't be fucking greedy. Don't be greedy. If you're a dev, don't be greedy. Because players see through it. The big players all see through it. Don't be greedy. And then two, hear what the community says. Don't just rely on like a few content creators and whatever. I'm not throwing shade at guns. I'm just saying like,
hey, none taken.
Take in the feedback of the community and recalibrate frequently. If something sucks, like admit something sucks. The good thing about this game is like nothing is defined. The only thing that's defined are artifacts, commanders, and your troops. That's it. Nothing else is defined. Obviously, maybe a type of troops, right? Like there's nothing that's defined, right? Because it's just artifacts, commanders, troops, city themes. And city themes, honestly, is more marginal, slightly more cosmetic. But it's the type of troops, commanders, artifacts that more or less define the meta.
Has the RNG changed throughout like the duration, like with the artifacts? So at one point it was worth investing in, but the RNG, man, it dropped like very poorly. Like,
so I honestly... Again, this is what I say. There's some things that I don't have great perspective over. That's one of the things I don't have great perspective over. And frankly, I am not in a position to say it's one way or the other, to be honest. Because I don't want to come off as naive either. But frankly, it hasn't been something I've been focused on. I'm just saying there's general principles in the sense that game developers made this game to make money. We know that.
Mm-hmm.
But game developers at times get too fucking greedy. a la Rise of Kingdoms. You build too many layers in the game, and people fucking hate it. You can never catch up. People are spending way too much money.
Crystal
and tech. you don't ever create sufficient new players versus those that are burning out, and that's how a game dies, right? So don't get too greedy. First and foremost. Second is to adapt and respond to what the community wants, as broadly defined as possible. That is reasonable from a revenue standpoint, but appeases a player base. Let me give you an example of that. Let me give you an example, because examples are powerful. Now, I would say, and this is more in the camp of innovation, and well, not innovation, but evolution, rather than monetization, if you will. Like, personally, I find this whole army group thing like very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting. because
a lot of question marks right now.
Because effectively, it changes the meta of the game. You're not doing the same thing. It's encouraging you to do something differently this season than the last 4 or 5 seasons that you played. Very differently. Very, very differently. And if it proves out to be the case, and none of us really know, there's a lot of details to this shit, at which I am not going to reveal the details thereof. And of course, I'm sure people and motherfuckers are going to be spamming admin question mark in chat. I would too. There's a lot of details that we don't know, but the reality is the army group structure changes the whole meta of this game. And why is it relevant? It's relevant for 2 or 3 things. One, you would have said, and if you actually watch most KVKs, and Noir doesn't have this problem, but I have the luxury of watching most KVKs, most KVKs do not have enough infantry.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying by just the sheer number of KVKs, not like Noir versus your next number 2 alliance. Like, you guys have a lot of infantry. Let's be real. I watched you guys. Man, my fucking iPad, almost melted.
Yep. Is that what you play on? Real. Is that what you play on an iPad?
No, I play on my PC. I play on my PC because I have 2 accounts. I play on my PC and my iPad at the same time. I play 2 accounts at the same time.
Oh, nice.
So, like, most kingdoms don't have enough infantry. Most kingdoms have no cav. If you haven't tried, and I think Guns, you made a video about this, I think it was like a month ago, where you're talking about the number 1 merit scorer in your kingdom. He was a cav player. Now, I want you to wrap your imagination around 2 alliances, 20 fully maxed, 20 fully maxed Tobin and Urag marches out on the field with unyielding rush, charging at a mage alliance. Guess what happens to that mage alliance? With 1.5 million troops per march, so that's 30 million cavalry hitting one mage march of 300k. Guess what happens to that mage march?
Absolutely obliterated. I've seen it happen.
You're like, probably losing like 90% of your troops.
We played against BXS and they had like surprisingly so many cav mains in their alliance. They had at least like 10 guys that were constantly running around with 5 marches, and bro, they were just T5 marches were just at the blink of an eye just gone.
So I play everything because my sole objective is to make, if you fight me, my sole objective is to make you run out of troops very fast. So you kill something that's like infantry arch, I'm sending cavs at you. You kill my cavs, I send my archers at you. Eventually, I know you're going to run out of troops before I do. But one thing that we know from testing, and obviously you played this and you saw this at a very, very high end level, is cavs are good for one purpose. Actually, two purposes. And post nerf, what's changed? It's changed a little bit up to this season, which is the size of army groups, plus the benefit of march speed via seasonal talents. Plus, essentially, what's the now unyielding rush? You know, if you think about it, it's, you know, five marches in one army group, 300k max. That's 1.5 million. Mm-hmm. You have 10 army groups in one alliance. That's, you know, 15 million. Most alliances have essentially, yeah, most kingdoms essentially have two or three shells, right? And if you're in a super active kingdom, I mean, just imagine you had 30 rallies of fucking Koresh Skobel on the field with 1.5 million marches each. Just imagine 45 million T5 infantry running at you. If you don't have 45 infantry to back it up, you're kind of dead. So the implication is obviously mage and archer meta this season is more or less dead. That's interesting innovation, actually, in my opinion. And did that take, spending? No. It took essentially feedback from the devs, which essentially said Kaz were fucking useless for the most part. They were. Like, you're feeding merits as Cav. Unless you're like hyper pay to win player, like, you're not going to sustain Cav. Like, there's no fucking way. Yeah. If you're free to play, there's just like, it's not happening. Like, it's a fucking dream at fantasy, right? And so they took that feedback, they made it something useful. And we'll see with this. I mean, obviously, I'm speculating, right? And clearly, at this point, no one's actually unlocked it. And there are specific strategies in relation to this to consider in the future. And I would be shocked if people didn't test it to see if it works once we can, I guess, unlock it. I don't know. What is it? 2 days? Something like that? No, 12 hours?
Yeah, 12 probably hours? Sooner than that. Yeah, so...
12 hours? So, like, I'd be interested to see how Noir plays with that, right? Because I think long range... My personal bias, I think long range warfare is a bit of a bait this season. It looks good on paper, but if you look at the incentives that they're throwing at you, there's essentially no benefit to long range warfare. It doesn't do shit for you. And then actually, I've seen videos on this, which is not really sensible in my view. The value of Danfel and Mogrel is not in the value of Danfel and Mogrel. It's actually the artifact. That's actually the real value. That's actually the real value. The artifact is a real
value. Shit looks fun to use too, though. Like, just straight body. You're straight bodying them, dude.
Used it in Roots of War. Because the truth is, like, how many times do you get stuck on a bridge or a ramp? Answer, a lot. Yeah. For me, I'm not Noir, so I get stuck on a ramp. Okay? That's the truth. You get stuck on a ramp, and you're like, I can't get out of this. Fuck, I just dropped my phone. You're just like, I can't, you know, get off this ramp. That's the value of this artifact. And we'll see. I mean, this is going to be an interesting season. Interesting season for us. And I don't know. I mean, it's probably 50-50 for us, but we'll make sure we have fun.
No, yeah, like, one of the Face of Blade, by the way, is, like, in love with you right now talking about fucking Cavs because he's a Cav main. And
it's the truth. I mean, it's just the numbers, bro.
It's true, yeah. I know I've talked to a few Cav mains. Like, they're planning on being leaders of one of the army groups, and then their other four marches running their Cavs with it as well.
It's fucking broken. So, I mean, we'll see how it plays. We'll see, obviously...
A Gorish Skogul 1.5 million in there is gonna go fucking insane, dude.
The only downside is
there's so much counter damage, dude.
The only downside to an army group is you do have obviously fewer legions on the field as a result, and so it does frankly come down to purely activity. And actually the meta is, I'm giving away some secrets here, in ROK, the meta at one point became the farm meta. where a rally leader would start a rally and no one will actually fill the rally because it would be the farms that fill the rally.
Mm.
And it, the strongest players didn't lose any troops. It was the farms, which they didn't give a shit, right?
Yeah.
This is essentially the same thing. This is the farm meta. Now, our opponents happen to be Korean players who have a lot of quote-unquote farms. I'm using quotes liberally here. But
it is
what it is. Let's just call it is what it is. Quote-unquote farms. Okay? And if you utilize it correctly, technically, if you have a lot of farms, you can have essentially, like, especially big kingdoms, you can probably have 30, 40 army groups just filled with farms. And up to this point, you would have said, having a lot of, like, we kick a lot of farms out of our kingdom because we just don't want dead power. Like, right now, if you look at our alliance, we only have 170-something members out of 200, and that's deliberate. Like, we don't have that many farms. So, mm-hmm. That's the trade-off. It's like, you fight someone that has a lot of quote-unquote farms, they can have, like, 30 army groups, and you're kind of fucked, right? Like, you can't beat that. Honestly, it's also a way, if you think about it in detail, for someone to deal with a garrison issue, right? Because I'm sure you've rallied a siege bastion and it fucking takes like an eternity.
Mm-hmm.
The ROK meta was never about rallies that would last eternity. The ROK meta actually was ultimately about large swarms of troops swarming towers when it was below a certain level of health. This game is not going to be that different. So imagine. And remember, the maximum number of units that you can swarm an object is 10. So if you have a rally and 9 army groups swarming an objective, that is essentially, what, 12.5 million plus a rally hitting one objective? Think about that.
It's going to be nuts, bro. That's what, like, that's what I've been trying to tell people. Like, if people are like, nah, army groups are going to be, they're not going to be that good. I'm like, bro, how can you say that? You're literally controlling a fucking rally of infantry or calves. Like, it is insane. Because, I mean, one of the problems that you'll see in some skirmish lines, like, infantry aren't being properly used. You'll see, like, one go in by itself and just get absolutely obliterated. Instead of like an organized like 5 to 7 tanks going up at a time, a lot of the noir war leads do pretty good on that. Like, all right, just another 5 or 7, like not all the infantry go push up. And now with the freaking army groups, it's going to be even easier to kind of manage that in. Like, all right, first army group go in or two. Like, it's going to be nuts. It's going to be nuts. Exactly. On that note, are you the war lead for your alliance or?
Of course. Man.
Okay.
Course, definitely.
I know there's some whales that just fucking don't like to deal with any kind of managing or anything like that. They just like to sign on and just fucking kill shit. So
no, I mean, put it this way, I'm of this general view. If someone is this is a general view in life, if someone is better at something than you are, you should let them do it, right? That's the truth.
Yeah,
like, why, you know, why go pick up your McDonald's when you can pay $3 for Uber Eats to do it, right? Like, why? If someone can be a better war lead than I can, they should be the war lead. But for now, I'm the war lead. And, but, you know, honestly, part of it is again, I'm sure you can appreciate, we are still a relatively young kingdom. Like, we're 314. Like, we're not that old of a kingdom. We're not even a year. And honestly, if you're dealing with situations like that, not many players actually have played games like this, right? Like, like, I'm an OG, quote-unquote OG guy from ROK days, so, like, I've dealt with this. I know how to do all the markers, call shots, call movement, call when to push, call when to back, you know, so on and so forth. Like, I've done that many, many times. So it's a learning experience for most, but what I try to do is I try to teach people, these are the principles that you need to understand when you're calling shots in war, which is location, timing, and when to advance and when to pull back. Like, that's it. Like, it's not a hard game. It's just, it's not hard. But you got to be communicative, and you have to be able to think quickly under pressure, which it is what it is.
Dragonflame says, 600 million, you think he's a barbershop of the Alliance? Of course he's the war leader. I mean, guys, I know some of you guys might say, of course he's going to be the war lead, but I'm sure even he can attest. Don't. Like, it's not exactly,
some
yeah.
Like, I played him many times. Like, I played with, like, really good rally leaders back in ROK days, and they maybe say like 5 or 6 words in like a 2-hour war.
Nah, I personally like when war leads are like very active with their callings. On top of that, it keeps people engaged, right? When you're on fucking hour 30 and your war lead's not saying shit and you're playing with one eye open, like, it's all part of, like, you know, kind of just the vibes and getting people going as well.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
But, yeah, I can say at least for Noir, like, it's been pretty good. There was one time where it was, like, 3 a.m. that no one was saying nothing. But, I mean, that's kind of expected when everyone's been up for 30-plus hours at a time.
That's an opportunity for you, my man. Like, this is when you step up and be like, yo, I'm live on YouTube, fuckers. Listen to me.
Yeah, hell no. For the first right, year, bro. For the first year, go ahead.
I was going to say, on that note, I do have to hop. I said 15 minutes. It turned out to be longer than 15 minutes.
Hey, we appreciate
this
that.
This was very enjoyable for me. Secondarily, and probably most importantly, I like the good vibes, so keep it up. And, you know, we'll see. Maybe by the end of the season, I'll be so despondent by the fact that we lost. I'll come here crying for mommy, but we'll see.
No, yeah, I definitely appreciate your support. I mean, for the stream and in the game, bro, because you know what I mean? It's huge. On top of that, you're a very chill guy. I've dealt with other whales in the past that I personally wouldn't talk to because they're fucking assholes. But I mean, even the chat has been saying like, damn, this guy's super chill. So appreciate
no,
you.
Fucking asshole, guys.
I appreciate you. Giving us the time.
I just don't know.
During your business trip, too.
Yeah, I'm good. No, I appreciate it. We're pretty chill. Obviously, you know, during war, shit gets heated. But, you know, it is what it is. This is a game. At the end of the day, guys, it's a game. Show up, play, have fun, spend money. You know, just chill. It's just a fucking game. It's just a game.
For sure. All
right, bro.
All right, brother. Good appreciate talk. You. Take care.
Have a good rest of your stream. Peace.
All right, our guy YY came in. That was a good chat, man. That was a good chat. He's actually, I've spoken to some other whales in Rise of Kingdoms in the past, but never in like a YouTube kind of. I just gave my notice to Saturn. Oh damn! No, Saturo's a savage himself. I like Saturo. He's super chill. Super chill, very supportive of the stream. But just to end this recording, guys, I hope that you guys enjoyed that interview. Actually, that was actually my first like official like voice interview. I'm not really a fan of doing interviews because I have to be able to vibe with the person. So, you know, when YY said that he was down to do the interview, I kind of rolled the dice because I'm like, man, this can go bad or really good, right? Because everyone, you kind of vibe with people different, and that definitely wasn't the case with YY. I always love being in the Discord and just talking with people. I don't like to think of it of like, you know, going forward, if anyone, whether you're an R5, a top fighter, an R4, if anyone, if I end up doing like another interview, I don't like to think about it as an interview, bro. We're just having a conversation. That's kind of like the environment that like I like to do. I mean, as you can tell, like I didn't have any like list of notes or whatever. You guys were actively talking in the chat. So I mean, if you guys enjoyed this, let me know in the comment section below who else you guys would want me to talk to. And we can try to arrange it. Like I said, I'm not the biggest fan of them. But if the vibe is right, we can try to make it happen. All right, guys. So I hope that you guys enjoyed the video. If you enjoyed the video, make sure you drop a like on the video. Definitely helps the channel out. If you're enjoying this content, make sure you hit that sub button. Turn that bell notification so you don't miss out on any other content. That's going to be it for this one, guys. Until next time, it's your boy Guns, and I'm out. Peace.